Princeton University Press Audio presents So Simple a Beginning: How Four Physical Principles Shape Our Living World by Raghuveer Parthasarathy. Read by Anand Jagatia. In memory of my parents, Kalyani and Sampath Parthasarathy. Introduction. How does life work? This question may seem overwhelming or even preposterous. How could any answer do justice to both a sprinting cheetah and a stationary tree? To the unique you, along with the trillions of bacteria that live inside you? The experiences of even a single organism are breathtakingly varied. Consider a chick's emergence from its egg, the first flap of its wings, the racing of its heart at the sight of a fox, and its transformation of food and water into eggs of its own. Could any intellectual framework encompass all of this? The search for an answer, for some kind of unity amid the diversity of life, is reflected in our ancient urge to categorize living things based on similarities of appearance or behavior. Aristotle partitioned animals into groups using attributes such as laying eggs or bearing live young. Ancient Indian texts applied a variety of classifiers, including, similarly, manner of origin. Those born from an egg, those born from an embryonic sac, those born from moisture, and those born from sprout. Modern taxonomy emerged from the 18th century work of Carl Linnaeus, who systematized the naming of organisms and developed a hierarchical classification scheme based on shared characteristics that we continue to find useful. Classification in itself, however, is not very satisfying. We want to know the why, not just the what, of the commonalities that unify living things. In this book, we look for that why through the lens of physics, revealing a surprising elegance and order in biology. Of course, this isn't the only perspective that offers deep insights into life. There is the viewpoint of biochemistry, with which we understand how atoms join together to form the molecular components of organic matter, how energy is deposited in and extracted from chemical bonds, and how the incessant flux of matter and energy in chemical reactions constitutes the metabolism of living things. But it is difficult to use chemistry alone to zoom out from the scale of molecules to the scales of the animals and plants around us, or even the scale of single cells, and make sense of shape and form. Another all-encompassing perspective is that of evolution. Since the mid-19th century epiphanies of Charles Darwin and Alfred Russell Wallace, we can see the traits of living creatures as manifestations of deeper historical processes. Similarities, whether of visible characteristics of anatomy or more hidden patterns in DNA sequences, can reflect shared ancestry, with which we can deduce a tree of relationships linking all of life together. Differences emerge due to random chance and the varied pressure on survival imposed by creatures' environments. Again, present forms reflect past history. Evolution provides a powerful framework for understanding life. It is not, however, one that we focus on in this book. In part, this is because there is already a large popular literature on the subject. More importantly, however, evolutionary principles alone don't illuminate the why as much as the how. To illustrate what I mean by why, consider the swim bladder, a pair of gas-filled sacs possessed by many but not all species of fish. Comparing creatures both extant and extinct reveals this organ's evolutionary history, with connections to the emergence of lungs in air-breathing animals that Darwin himself remarked upon. Understanding the function of a swim bladder, however, requires a bit of physics. The low density of the enclosed gas offsets the high density of bone in bony fishes, allowing the animal to maintain the same average density as its watery surroundings, and thereby easily position itself at whatever depth it likes. A swim bladder is just one solution to the challenge of matching density. The fish might instead contain large amounts of low-density oil, or a skeleton composed of cartilage rather than bone, both of which are strategies adopted by sharks, which lack a swim bladder. The last common ancestor of cartilaginous and bony fish lived over 400 million years ago. Since then, the distinct evolutionary paths of the two groups have led to different solutions to the shared physical challenges of aquatic locomotion. We can state, with a point of view echoed throughout this book, that understanding the why of these anatomical features, related to control of density, highlights a hidden unity that fish share, that transcends their evolutionary divergence. We should keep in mind, however, that the machinery of variation and natural selection, the enhanced odds of survival that accrued over generations to those creatures better able to navigate their aquatic world, provides the paths by which the forms we see arise. There are other vantage points besides those of biochemistry and evolution from which to survey the breadth of life. Rather than list all the approaches we won't be exploring, however, let's turn to the one we will. I've already hinted at the view of nature the rest of this book expands upon, which I identify as biophysical. The term implies a unification of biology and physics. It encapsulates the notion that the substances, shapes, and actions that constitute life are governed and constrained by the universal laws of physics, and that illuminating the connections between physical rules and biological manifestation reveals a framework upon which the dazzling variety of life is built. The notion of universality is central to the utility of physics and to its appeal. The same principles of gravity apply to an apple falling from a tree and to planets orbiting the sun. And current work aims to further expand this framework to encompass the strange behaviour of the quantum world. Biophysics extends to the living world the quest for unity that lies at the heart of physics. To say that living things obey the laws of physics may seem trivial. After all, organisms are made up of the same fundamental particles that make up everything else, and are therefore governed by the same rules. But one might expect the explicit role of physics to be over after physical forces set up the formation of atoms and molecules, with complex chemistry giving shape to further molecular rearrangements, and the idiosyncratic predilections of cells and organisms being responsible for larger features. This is, however, incorrect. Just as physical forces direct the intricate branching of frost on a winter window, and the rhythmic curves of vast desert dunes, and do so in ways that don't require subatomic particles for their explanation, physical mechanisms shape life at all scales. One of the great triumphs of physics, especially over the last half century, has been an understanding of how broad rules arise in all sorts of natural phenomena, clearing the underbrush of complexity to reveal deep principles. Magnets, for example, become non-magnetic if heated above some specific critical temperature. Though magnets can be made of many different elements and alloys, each with their own unique atomic scale structure, the magnetic field of every magnet decays with exactly the same form as it approaches its critical temperature. Being a three-dimensional arrangement of interacting atoms, it turns out, suffices to determine the consequences of those interactions, regardless of atomic details. As another example, consider a shaken container of mixed nuts. One typically finds that the larger nuts rise to the top, giving this well-known phenomenon its name, the Brazil nut effect. The effect isn't particular to nuts, of course, and occurs in mixtures of cereal grains, rocks on riverbeds, and any collection of agitated, disordered objects. Its explanation involves general notions of what are called granular flows, and the ways in which any ensemble of colliding particles must create and fill in interstitial spaces in order to move. Biophysics applies this quest for broadly applicable physical rules to the world of living things. This endeavour, though still incomplete, has already been far more successful than we might have dreamed, even a few decades ago. Using physics, we can understand the bursting of DNA from viruses, fundamental limits on the speed of thought, and the regular spacing of our vertebrae. We can apply our insights to grow organs on slabs of plastic and read genomes using pulses of light. We uncover a simplicity and an elegance in the living world that is otherwise hidden. Simplicity emerges because a handful of principles, rather than a morass of detail, suffices for many explanations. elegance because of the unity shared by the living and non-living world. This is an unusual point of view. I hope what follows will convince you of it. Every quest for unity amid complexity risks the pitfall of hubris, however. There is the temptation to ignore the lessons that variety provides, or to force motley data into unreasonably simple frameworks. A physical perspective is especially prone to these missteps, perhaps because of the elegance of its theories, and perhaps because of their historical successes. Despite being a physicist myself, I note that the caricature of physicists as blithely trampling, elephant-like, through adjacent fields of inquiry without adequately appreciating the treasures underfoot is not wholly inaccurate. Though this book is a celebration of biophysics, I'll describe some of its stumbles as well. Chapter 12 in particular examines contentious issues of metabolism, against which a biophysical approach may have failed. What are the physical principles that govern living things? We could refer to laws related to fundamental forces, thermodynamics, probability, and so on, amenable to precise mathematical formulation. While rigorous, this would be rather dry and would moreover obscure the overarching lessons that biophysicists have drawn from nature. Instead, I direct our attention to four concepts or motifs that arise repeatedly in biophysical explorations. The first is self-assembly, the idea that the instructions for building with biological components, whether molecules, cells, or tissues, are encoded in the physical characteristics of the components themselves. It may seem obvious that an organism contains its own instructions. After all, one doesn't need to carve a tree into a tree shape or paste five arms on a starfish. The creatures organize their own forms. Their internal instructions, however, need not take the form of a task list written into one set of components and executed by another. Rather, the physical characteristics of biological materials often are the instructions. Features like size and shape can guide the arrangement of pieces into a larger whole, as can less visible attributes such as electrical charge, harnessing the laws of physics. I'll illustrate with an example. If you've ever blown soap bubbles and watched them come together, you may have noticed that there's never a junction at which more than three bubbles meet. Physical forces drive soap films to minimize their surface area, leading to incontrovertible rules for sets of bubbles that have been appreciated since their 19th century elaboration by Belgian physicist Joseph Plateau. These rules prohibit any junction of four bubbles, as such a junction could never be part of a minimal area surface. The arrangements of bubbles aren't haphazard. No external hand, however, is needed to guide them into their stereotyped pattern. The rules for their organisation are embedded in their physical nature. For well over a century, scientists have noticed that arrangements of adjoining cells in all sorts of tissues resemble the arrangements of soap bubbles, and have investigated whether this is coincidence or a reflection of similar underlying mechanisms. In 2004, for example, Takashi Hayashi at the University of Tokyo and Richard Carthew at Northwestern University looked at the cluster of photoreceptor cells, situated in each of a fruit fly's compound eyes. Normally there are four, with exactly the same arrangement as four soap bubbles. Using mutant flies that developed 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6 photoreceptor cells per group, they found the same arrangements that one finds in assemblies of 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6 adjoining soap bubbles. The fly, it seems, relies on general physical mechanisms of surface area minimization to organize these crucial cells of its retina. Rather than painstakingly positioning cells, the fly makes the cells and lets them sort out their contacts, minimize their areas, and pattern themselves on their own. The cells, like the soap bubbles, assemble themselves. In countless other contexts as well, we similarly find that structure isn't drawn explicitly into the blueprints of an organism. Rather, nature places the raw materials at the site and trusts that the laws of physics will put them together properly. Thankfully, the laws of physics are reliable workers. The second recurring motif is that of a regulatory circuit. The ubiquity of computers makes us familiar with the idea that machines can use rules of logic to transform inputs into outputs, making decisions based on signals from sensors or controllers. We're also comfortable with the idea that living creatures, ourselves included, make behavioural choices based on the stimuli in their environment, though the details of the computations are more mysterious. We'll see that decision-making circuitry is not just a feature of the large-scale world, but is manifested in the microscopic activities of life's molecules, built into their very structure and modes of interaction. The wet, squishy building blocks of life assemble into machines that can sense their environment, perform calculations, and make logical decisions. A migrating cell in a developing embryo, for example, must stop its wandering when it reaches the appropriate destination, a decision determined in part by assessing the mechanical stiffness of the neighbouring tissue. Cells adhere using proteins that jut out from their surfaces, and through these proteins they can tug on their surroundings. Some adhesion proteins can serve as sensors as well as anchors, with these two roles inexorably linked. For stiff surroundings, the protein molecules are stretched, as your arm would be if tugging on a thick tree branch from a few feet away. For soft surroundings, the proteins are bent, as your arm would be if pulling on a towel on a clothesline, easily dragged toward you. The cell contains other components that combine to sites on the adhesion protein only if those sites are exposed, which occurs only if the molecule is stretched. Imagine the inside of your elbow, accessible as you tug on the tree, but not on the towel. This binding triggers events that culminate in the cell's decision to stop its wandering. The physical conformation of the protein, therefore, underpins a cell-scale machine that senses, calculates, and decides. Our third concept is that of predictable randomness. The physical processes underlying the machinery of life are fundamentally random, but paradoxically, their average outcomes are reliably predictable. In the non-living world, randomness is central to activities as diverse as the shuffling of cards and the collisions of gas molecules. Physics has long tackled the question of how robust features emerge from underlying chaos. We know, for example, why steady, consistently coloured light shines from stars, despite their churning interiors, and how energy can be extracted from the violent combustion of gasoline. The microscopic world is subject to incessant, vigorous, and fundamentally random motion that DNA and other cellular components must deal with and even exploit. We can deduce the probable outcomes of random processes, which in many cases provide simple explanations of superficially complex phenomena. A virus reaching a cell that it may infect, for example, doesn't need to think, even if it were capable of thought, about how to find the specific surface proteins to which it can bind. It is buffeted by random forces that drag it everywhere, ensuring that its chaotic trajectory will intersect its target. Your immune system also makes use of randomness, generating an enormous variety of receptor proteins that might, by chance, recognize invaders that have never before been encountered. We devote all of Chapter 6 to the randomness of microscopic motion, which finds echoes in discussions of genes and traits, where randomness is also built into the way life works. Our final recurring biophysical motif is that of scaling, the idea that physical forces depend on size and shape in ways that determine the forms accessible to living, growing, and evolving organisms. That size, shape, and physics are related is well appreciated for artificial structures. It's hard to build big buildings, for example. Before the advent of steel frames and other modern inventions, to attempt great heights or large interior spaces was to tempt collapse, as the weight of a structure could overwhelm the support its walls could provide. Simply scaling up a small building, maintaining the proportionality of its dimensions, fails. In modern language that we elaborate in Chapter 10, gravity and other forces scale with size in different ways that we need to account for when designing buildings. Scaling concepts are similarly reflected in the sizes and shapes of animals, but extend to much more than mechanical concerns. Scaling illuminates aspects of living forms, from the existence of lungs to, perhaps, the rate of our metabolism. These four themes don't exist in isolation, but can interact with and even depend on each other, as we'll hear in the chapters to come. The precision of biological circuits often depends on the statistics of random motion. Random motion nudges the positions of biological components to facilitate their self-assembly. Self-assembly into larger structures is subject to the dictates of scaling laws. All these processes and principles together create the explanatory framework of biophysics. Understanding life brings with it the ability to influence life. This isn't in itself a new insight. Our knowledge of the immune system and the behaviour of microorganisms, among other topics, has enabled us to triumph over a multitude of diseases that ravaged humanity in the past. In the 20th century alone, for example, more than 300 million people died of smallpox, a disease that has now vanished thanks to the invention of vaccines. Our knowledge of genetics, biochemistry, and many other subjects lets us coax plants and animals to produce enough food for over 7 billion people, four times as many as inhabited the planet just 100 years ago. In recent years, we've learned how to alter organisms at their core, directly reading the information carried in genomes and rewriting it to modify form and function. As we'll hear, these contemporary advances require taking seriously a biophysical view of life, acknowledging the tangible, physical character of DNA and other molecules to design tools that quite literally push, pull, cut, and connect life's pieces. A biophysical perspective also helps us make sense of the implications of these new biotechnologies and the difficult choices they bring. We'll encounter, for example, methods to engineer the extinction of the mosquitoes that spread malaria, dengue fever, and other diseases, bringing to mind both the dismal legacy of human-induced extinctions and the uplifting histories of past eradications of disease. The decision whether to employ such methods requires understanding how they work and how they differ from past tools. At a more personal level, our ability to read our own genetic code brings with it the prediction of likelihoods of various illnesses in ourselves or in our children. Our nascent ability to edit genomes offers the chance to alter these likelihoods. What would it mean to alter the genome of an unborn child to try to avoid cystic fibrosis, or cancer, or depression? Whether to take such an action is both a deeply personal decision and one with serious ethical and societal implications. Making such decisions can and should be aided by an understanding of what genes, genomes, cells, and organisms actually are, and the processes that shape the relationships among them. As we'll hear, the physical nature of life's materials, as well as fundamental issues related to randomness and uncertainty, influence what we can and cannot do with our new technologies. Our exploration of biophysical themes includes examples spanning the variety of life. We consider the normal workings of organisms, including ourselves, as well as the pitfalls of disease and the intersections of biology and technology. In part one, The Ingredients of Life, our journey begins inside cells. We delineate the pieces that make up living things, materials like DNA and proteins that also exemplify a sort of universality as they make up every living thing ever discovered. The molecular characters in this first part of the story will likely be familiar from high school biology, but we focus on the physical traits that guide their functions. We find stiff strands of DNA, two-dimensional liquids that define cell boundaries, and three-dimensional sculptures made of single molecules. In part two, Living Large, we expand our horizons to look at communities of cells, including embryos, organs, and the consortia of bacteria that live inside each of us. We also explore scaling relationships that govern the shapes of animals and plants, revealing why an elephant can never be as athletic as an antelope. In part three, Organisms by Design, we return to the microscopic world of DNA. But now, having developed deeper connections between molecules and organisms, we tackle the genome. We learn what it means to read, write, and edit DNA, learn how nature itself pointed us toward the tools that make these feats possible, and examine the opportunities and challenges these technologies present for our future. As interesting as these topics and examples may be, their cumulative effect is greater than the sum of their parts. Biophysics transforms the way we look at the world. At the end of On the Origin of Species, Darwin writes, "There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers, having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one, and that, whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. I hope to convince you that nature has a grandeur even deeper than what Darwin discerned. Rather than a contrast between the fixed clockwork laws of physics and the generation of endless and beautiful forms, the two are inextricably linked. We can identify the crucial, simple beginning not as the origin of life, nor the formation of our planet, but as the primeval emergence of the physical laws that characterize our universe. The influence of these laws on life didn't end billions of years ago, but rather shaped and continues to shape all the wonderful forms around us and within us. To discern simplicity amid complexity, and to draw connections between life's diverse phenomena and universal physical concepts gives us a deeper appreciation of ourselves, our fellow living creatures, and the natural world that we inhabit. I hope you'll agree. Part 1. The Ingredients of Life. Chapter 1. DNA, a code and a cord. A beige gelatinous slab, speckled with bacterial colonies, hangs in the National Portrait Gallery in London. The bacteria contain copies of DNA from the artwork's subject, Nobel laureate John Sulston. Though Sulston's friends probably wouldn't recognise the likeness, the artist, Mark Quinn, notes that the piece is the most realistic portrait in the portrait gallery because it carries the actual instructions that led to the creation of John. These days, even small children are taught that DNA somehow makes you, you, setting the colour of your eyes, the shape of your nose, your fondness for cilantro, and more. We've grown accustomed to the idea that DNA encodes instructions that govern us. But what does encodes actually mean? We begin our biophysical exploration of the machineries and mechanisms of life with DNA. It is iconic and familiar, yet abstract in many descriptions we encounter. Understanding how instructions are embedded in DNA occupies us for a few chapters as we introduce proteins, genes, and networks of interactions among these constituents. Scientists' conceptions of how these pieces form, both a message and the means of reading this message, have evolved over the past few decades, and DNA's intricacies are still being unravelled. Recent years have seen the development of breathtaking ways to manipulate the code contained in DNA for ends not yet fully imagined, a subject we examine in Part 3. In this chapter, we focus on DNA alone, which already allows us to introduce connections between biology and physics, and between science and technology. Four views of DNA. More than just a set of abstract instructions, DNA is a substance with shape and structure whose physical properties are intimately tied to its functions. What is this substance? Is it solid or liquid? Stiff or floppy? Compressed or relaxed? DNA is multifaceted, and we can focus on different aspects of it depending on what we care about. Here are four views of DNA. Number 1. DNA is a colourless goo. We can hold DNA in our hands and see it with our unaided eyes. This isn't hard to do. A blender and some kitchen chemicals enable the extraction of DNA from a bowl of strawberries or a cup of peas. The recipe is roughly this. Puree the fruits or vegetables in a blender, ripping their cells apart from each other. Add detergent to disintegrate cellular membranes. Sprinkle a dash of meat tenderizer or pineapple juice, supplying enzymes that digest proteins. DNA is now the only cellular component left intact. Add rubbing alcohol, which dissolves the protein pieces but not the DNA. The DNA clumps into long strands you can draw out with a toothpick, collecting a cloudy, stringy, white blob. That's DNA. It's not an awe-inspiring sight. I was once brought to tears extracting DNA during a classroom demonstration, but that was because I made the terrible decision to use onions as my source material. Conveniently colourless, but a painful puree. Number 2. DNA is a code. At the other extreme of tangibility, we can think of DNA as an abstract code composed of four symbols. These symbols are often denoted by letters A, T, C, G, but four coloured squares work just as well. The particular sequence of symbols conveys information about how your cells should build what they need to build and do what they need to do. How much information? Let's compare it to the amount of digital information stored in a portable music player. These days, we're used to thinking about bits and bytes, units of information. A bit, or binary digit, is anything that can have just two values, yes or no, 0 or 1, a magnet pointing north or south. A 1 gigabyte thumb drive has about 8 billion bits of information, giga meaning billion, and a byte being 8 bits. Its contents can be expressed as a particular string of 8 billion ones and zeros. 0111010100110010001001, etc. How many bits is each person's DNA sequence? 3 billion symbols, that is, 3 billion A's, T's, C's, and G's, make up your DNA. We could make a dictionary like this, for example, to translate each symbol into a binary code. 00 is A. 01 is T, 10 is C, 11 is G. A sequence like ATTGC would be equivalent to 00101011110. Our 3 billion letter genome, therefore, carries 6 billion bits of information, less than a gigabyte, and probably a small fraction of the storage capacity of the phone in your pocket. This presents a puzzle. I seem much more complex than my phone, despite my apparent paucity of information. We grapple with the concept of complexity through much of this book. For now, there's a more immediate question. How does this abstract picture of codes and information relate to the stringy blob we heard about previously? Number 3. DNA is a molecule. Like all molecules, DNA consists of atoms. In its case, atoms of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and phosphorus, held together by chemical bonds. The four symbols of the code just mentioned are really four assemblies of atoms, called nucleotides, stitched together to form a long chain. Specifying the sequence of nucleotides in the chain suffices to identify a DNA molecule. The shorthand of ACTG is exactly equivalent to a specific array of atoms, and it can't refer to any other set of atoms than this. Number 4. DNA is a double helix. The interactions between atoms determine the structure of a molecule, and the structure of the molecule governs its function. Any of the four nucleotides, A, T, C, G, can be linked to any other to form a single strand of DNA. But the nucleotides also interact between strands, though more weakly in a specific way. A and T bind together, as do C and G. We say that A and T are complementary, as are C and G. A single strand of DNA, for example AGCCTATGA, binds its complementary strand, TCGGATACT. Interactions among the atoms drive the two DNA strands to wind around each other like twisting ivy, forming a double helix. This echoes the cartoon double helix we've all seen countless times. The smooth ribbons and well-ordered dots are a schematic of the more complicated arrangements of atoms and bonds in three-dimensional space. The iconic double helical form of DNA is functional as well as elegant. The two complementary strands convey redundant information. If I tell you the sequence of one strand, you know the other, since each nucleotide is the complement of its partner. This redundancy reveals how information can be transmitted from one cell to its two daughter cells as it divides. The DNA is unzipped and the complement of each original strand is synthesized, giving two DNA double helices from the original one. James Watson and Francis Crick figured out the structure of double-stranded DNA in 1953, based on exquisite X-ray measurements performed by Rosalind Franklin and graduate student Raymond Gosling. This story is a fascinating one, filled with cleverness and insight, as well as ethical lapses and tragedy, and it is well told elsewhere. Before this, no one knew what DNA molecules might look like. The most prominent hypothesis was from Linus Pauling, the chemist who first formulated the modern notion of a chemical bond, who suspected that it formed a three-stranded twisted fibre, a triple helix. The revelation of the double helix made it clear how DNA structure might enable the transfer of genetic information by the copying of complementary strands. Other consequences of DNA structure are less obvious, though, and we're still unravelling the mysteries of DNA today. In living cells, as well as in sterile test tube solutions, single strands of DNA will spontaneously wrap themselves into a double helix if their nucleotides complement each other. No external scaffolding or microscopic ropes and pulleys are required. The DNA contains within itself the mechanism of its organisation, highlighting a theme of self-assembly that surfaces repeatedly in our explorations of life. Each of the four views of DNA just mentioned is useful, emphasising attributes relevant to various roles. The fibrous goo extracted from pureed cells may be homely, but all of the more glamorous uses of DNA, plucking it from cancer cells to map the genes they carry, harvesting it from crime scenes to track down suspects, and more, must acknowledge the material, corporeal character of DNA if they are to work. As an abstract code, the sequence of symbols specifies the information carried by the molecule. When we say that your DNA is unique, it means that your sequence of nucleotides, or coloured squares, is different from mine. It's only slightly different. Over 99% of our squares would match. When we say we know the genome of some organism, we mean that we know the full sequence of symbols. This tells us a lot, but it also leaves a great deal undetermined, as we'll hear. We might care about the atomic level of detail, the exact architecture of atoms making up DNA rather than just the symbolic code of constituents, if, for example, we're designing tools that cut DNA strands or splice them together, which we encounter in the context of genome editing in part 3. More often, however, the arrangement of the units, the A's, C's, G's and T's, suffices. The double-stranded helix describes how DNA is situated in space. The size, shape, stiffness and electrical charge of double-stranded DNA govern its packaging in cells, and the readout of information it contains. As our first illustration of the importance of the physical character of double-stranded DNA, let's look at a process that has transformed biotechnology: the polymerase chain reaction. Does DNA melt? Imagine you'd like to make an exact copy of some DNA. You could begin by separating the two strands of the double helix and then creating a new complementary strand for each of the resulting halves. That is, in fact, what your cells do every time they divide, with a particular protein machinery performing the initial unzipping of the double-stranded DNA. Outside of cells, we've developed another approach that allows us to replicate DNA at will, taking tiny amounts of DNA and transforming them into innumerable identical copies to yield enough material to run tests on or to transport to new targets. The tiny amounts of nucleotide strands could, for example, be swabbed from a crime scene to assess similarity to DNA from suspects, sampled from the amniotic fluid surrounding a fetus to search for genetic abnormalities or the presence of bacterial or viral DNA, excised from a tumour to map mutations in the nucleotide code indicative of cancer, or extracted from a Nobel Prize winner to be replicated and reinserted in fragments into bacteria that make up an artwork. Just as in natural replication, the artificial replication of DNA relies on drawing the double helix apart, which in turn relies on the physical phenomenon of phase transitions. Rather than asking how we might separate the two strands of a DNA double helix, Imagine asking how we could separate the tightly connected water molecules that make up an ice cube. We know the answer. We'd heat it. Above 0 degrees C, 32 degrees F, ice melts into liquid water, in which each water molecule meanders around, only transiently bound to any other molecule. In general, temperature is the nemesis of attraction and order, a recurring theme in physics. For water, the transition between a solid and liquid is sharp, occurring precisely at the melting temperature, which is 0 degrees C at standard atmospheric pressure. Even a few degrees below 0 degrees C, water is solid. Even slightly above, it's liquid. This transition isn't sharp for all substances, however. If you heat honey, it gets progressively less viscous, flowing more easily as the temperature rises, rather than suddenly changing at one particular temperature. Recalling that the bonds between the two strands of a DNA double helix are weaker than the bonds within a strand, we might expect that we could use heat to separate DNA strands, without destroying them. And this is, in fact, the case. But is the transformation sharp or smooth? In other words, does DNA have a melting transition? The answer is important if we want separation to enable replication. If there is a melting transition, we'd be assured that by raising the temperature, even to just a few degrees above the transition, we'd have complete separation. If there isn't a melting transition, we'd likely have some unseparated DNA that couldn't be copied. In the latter case, though we could keep heating until every last segment is completely separated, this would in practice likely require such high temperatures that the DNA itself and any other biological molecules that are present would be damaged. It turns out that for double-stranded DNA, the transition into single strands is a sharp one. DNA does melt. If we take a beaker containing DNA and heat it, the molecules are double-stranded up to a specific melting temperature, and just above this, they separate into single strands. Not only can we measure this in the lab, but we understand its origins. Making sense of phase transitions, transformations between liquid, solid, and gas, or between magnetic and non-magnetic forms, or between any of the different structures that materials might take, was one of the great triumphs of 20th century physics. The melting of DNA is a transition from order to disorder that maps onto other transitions, though with subtleties of its own. All phase transitions reflect a conflict between order and disorder. Order is typically driven by the energy associated with attraction or alignment, while disorder is often driven by geometry, the ways in which constituents can arrange themselves in space. Temperature amplifies the impact of disorder. At low temperatures, the tendency to be ordered wins. At high temperatures, disorder is dominant. Water molecules, for example, are marshalled into the crystalline arrangement of ice when cold. If warmer, they succumb to the randomness of being liquid. Our statement that the melting transition is sharp means that there's a specific temperature separating these two outcomes, and therefore a clear demarcation of the ordered and disordered phases. The energy of ordering and the varieties of disorder both depend on the dimensions the substance can explore. The consequences for phase transitions are dramatic. In general, theory predicts that one-dimensional materials shouldn't exhibit sharp transformations between phases. Water molecules arranged in a row, for example, wouldn't melt at a specific point. Disorder would emerge at even the coldest accessible temperature and would grow steadily as the temperature increases. To a good approximation, the long chain of double-stranded DNA is one-dimensional, rungs on a ladder, one after the other. Its sharp melting, readily observed in the lab, therefore seems to confound expectations. As strands become unbound, however, the liberated, flexible, single-stranded DNA bends and twists through three dimensions, subject to random forces common to all molecules, whose character we explore further throughout this audiobook. Though the motion is random, its consequences are robust and predictable, another recurring theme, as the resulting configurational freedom grants the overall separation a precise transition temperature, which is generally the case for three-dimensional materials. With experimental data and theoretical understanding in hand, we can even predict, for a given DNA sequence, the temperature at which it will come apart. These transition temperatures are typically around 95 degrees C, 200 degrees F, a bit below the boiling point of water, with the exact value depending on the particular nucleotide sequence. We can therefore separate DNA in a test tube just by heating it. The next task for our goal of replicating DNA is to create the complements of each strand. We could borrow the machinery that your cells use, called DNA polymerase, but these proteins would form a dysfunctional, rubbery glob, rather like a boiled egg white, at the temperatures necessary to melt the DNA. Egg whites are, in fact, mostly protein. There is, however, a clever way around this. We use DNA polymerase from bacteria that live in hot springs, creatures whose proteins have evolved to run smoothly when hot. Like all DNA polymerases, these require a little bit of double-stranded DNA to get started with their replication of a single strand. These ingredients were all in hand by the early 1980s. Bacteriologists discovered and purified the hot springs polymerase, for example, in 1976. In 1983, the recipe that combines nucleotides, polymerases, temperature and DNA came to scientist Carey Mullis during a late-night drive through California's Coast Range, along with the realization that this would enable simple and almost limitless replication of DNA. The process is now known as the polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. To perform PCR, we first gather the ingredients dissolved in a saltwater solution. The little bit of DNA we wish to replicate, DNA polymerase proteins, an abundance of individual nucleotides, A's, C's, G's and T's, and a lot of primers, segments of DNA just a few nucleotides long that are complements of the ends of the DNA to be copied. Next, we raise the temperature to around 95 degrees C, 200 degrees F, so that the DNA melts, giving two single strands from the original double helix. We next lower the temperature so that the primers will bind to the ends of the single-stranded DNA. There are a lot of primers, so it's much more likely that the single-stranded DNA encounters a primer than its former partner strand. We put predictable randomness to work for us. The polymerase will then bind and craft the complementary DNA strand. When it finishes, we have two double-stranded DNA helices from our original one. We then repeat. With one more cycle of warming and cooling, we end up with four DNA fragments. At the next round, 8, then 16, 32, 64, etc. 10 doublings give 1,024 pieces of DNA. 20 give over a million. 30 repetitions, not difficult with an automated heating and cooling machine, give over a billion. We can therefore take a little bit of DNA and turn it into a lot of identical DNA, amplifying our original whisper into a chorus of replicas to be used in whatever diagnostic, forensic, or therapeutic application we like. In living things, copying DNA requires the elaborate dance of reproduction, creating an entire new cell or even a new organism. With the polymerase chain reaction, we can copy DNA at will. The recipe is beautifully simple. As Mullis himself wrote, "The almost universal first response of molecular biologists upon learning about his invention was, 'Why didn't I think of that?'" Mullis continues, "And nobody really knows why. Surely I don't. I just ran into it one night." By replicating DNA, we can create enough copies to sequence it. In other words, to determine its particular pattern of nucleotides, using techniques that we describe in part 3. With this approach, we've mapped the genomes of humans and many other organisms. You may wonder, since PCR needs primers that bind to the DNA of interest, creating a short double-stranded span, don't we have to know the sequence we're amplifying before we even begin? Not quite. First of all, for many applications, we do know some part of the genome of the organism whose DNA we're working with, and can design primers that bind to this part. More generally though, we can cut the unknown DNA into fragments and link them to DNA that we know well, For example, the genomes of easily grown bacteria, using naturally occurring proteins that sew DNA strands together. Then, primers to the known part of the DNA can see the progression of DNA polymerase onto the unknown parts. It's with this approach, for example, that the genome of the woolly mammoth, an animal that's been extinct for several thousand years, was sequenced from ancient remains. The polymerase chain reaction is essential to nearly all of what we do with DNA, and it is made possible by bringing together quirks of biology, like heat-loving microorganisms and generalities of physics, melting phase transitions, each of which on their own may have seemed tangential to practical aims. PCR also highlights a message central to many modern technologies as well as natural processes. DNA is more than a code or an abstraction, but is a tangible physical object. Especially with notions of self-assembly and predictable randomness in hand, we can understand and even invent methods to work with this crucial molecule. There's a lot more we can and will ask about DNA. How much do you have? How is it stored, organized, and deciphered by your cells? How could you alter the code written into your or your unborn child's genome? These questions tie together physical properties and biological functions. To answer them, though, we need to introduce another key player on the cellular stage: proteins. In the next chapter, we see what a protein is and examine the interplay between proteins and DNA. Chapter 2. Proteins, molecular origami. At the core of nearly every action, every task, and every event in your body is a protein. Proteins in red blood cells soak up oxygen from the air you breathe. Proteins tug on other proteins to contract your muscles. Proteins extend and retract protrusions with which immune cells squeeze through your tissues. Proteins in your eyes capture light and trigger electrical impulses, while other proteins open and close gates that send these impulses to your brain. Many kinds of proteins are inside every cell, and many are outside as well, making up, for example, the elastic matrix of your flesh. So, what are proteins? Like DNA, a protein is a molecule composed of a chain of simple units. In DNA, these units are any of four nucleotides. In proteins, these units are any of 20 amino acids. Double-stranded DNA, regardless of its nucleotide sequence, adopts a double helical structure. In contrast, proteins have structures that are determined by their particular amino acid sequences. Every distinct protein has a different pattern of amino acids, and therefore a different three-dimensional shape. The blueprints for the structure and the tools for its construction are encoded within the protein itself. Proteins provide perhaps the most striking manifestation of the theme of self-assembly, nature's encoding of instructions for organizing matter within the matter itself, to be activated and realized by universal physical forces. Though self-assembly isn't unique to living things, sand piles, for example, arrange themselves into cones tilted at specific angles, and soap bubbles form themselves into spheres, it is ubiquitous in biology. Considering proteins, we'll see how forces generate forms, how the process usually succeeds but sometimes catastrophically fails, and how computers struggle with geometric calculations that molecules perform in microseconds. Proteins in three dimensions. An amino acid chain in water bends, twists, and folds into a particular shape. Two very common motifs found in proteins are helices and sheets. Helices and sheets are often so common in protein structures that we often depict only stylized shapes. A smooth helix about 1 nanometer in diameter, 1/1,000,000th of a meter, and a sheet or ribbon about 1/3 of a nanometer wide, rather than showing every component atom. The first protein to have its three-dimensional structure revealed was myoglobin, a protein that carries oxygen in muscle, in 1958. As with DNA and many other molecules, this was made possible by illumination with X-rays, together with mathematical analysis of the resulting intensity patterns, in this case performed by a team led by John Kendrew at the University of Cambridge. X-ray imaging requires proteins to solidify into crystals, similar to the sugar crystals that you might make in your kitchen. And even now, there is an art to coaxing proteins to crystallize. Kendrew's team struggled with myoglobin from porpoises, penguins, seals, and other creatures before stumbling on sperm whale meat, conveniently on hand in the freezer of Cambridge's low-temperature research station. Deep-diving, air-breathing sea creatures have high concentrations of myoglobin in their muscles, allowing them to store more oxygen and surface less often, hence the focus on these animals. The sperm whale protein formed the most marvellous, gigantic crystals. From these, Kendrew and his team were able to determine that the 153 amino acid chain of myoglobin folds into a structure composed of 8 helices and some non-helical spans that together hold onto a flat compound containing a single iron atom that binds oxygen. We can turn again to the marine world for an example of a protein composed mainly of sheets. Green fluorescent protein, commonly called GFP, is a light-emitting protein first found in bioluminescent jellyfish. GFP is a chain of 238 amino acids, folded into a barrel of sheets about 3 nanometers wide that surrounds the part of the molecule responsible for colour. The protein has become much more than an oceanic curiosity. GFP has been engineered into bacteria, fungi, plants, and even animals as diverse as fruit flies and zebrafish, in which it serves as a beacon, allowing researchers to visualise particular types of cells and see how they grow, move, and divide. GFP can also be fused to other proteins, creating reporters that reveal where in cells these proteins are, how they behave as the cells perform various tasks, and how they associate with other proteins to form more complex architectures. A rich palette of fluorescent proteins now exists.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.